white women in my car, in my taxi. And one of the black students, one of the black young women said, "Well, just move over, I'll drive." And, "No, no, I can't do that." So the four black women got in the car, he drives off, and the other two are immediately set upon by members of the mob. And I have driven down from the bus terminal, I've driven down the street, there's an alley across the back of the parking lot, and there's just violence all over that park. They were just grabbing them, beating them, throwing them down. They had sticks and pipes, and so I go across the alley, down across the alley, bus terminal's here. I start back up the other side of the street, and I haven't seen these two young women, these two women who didn't get in the cab, until I get well up, like down, across, up. I'm just about halfway up the other side. And as I drive up, sir, and I am sick, you know, I mean, everything I'd come down there to do, provide safe conduct, has exploded into a sort of time bomb of violence. And so these two young women are there, and one of them is walking ahead, and she is being attacked by, there were people jeering her, shoving her, and they were jostling the one who was walking about 10 steps behind her. But the one ahead was bleeding from the nose and mouth, and I saw that. There was a young man in front of her, punching her, and a woman with a pocketbook, long held, is slapping her across the head with a pocketbook. And I thought, I can get them out of here. So I blew the horn, bounced up on the curb, got out of the car. The one who was walking behind, I yelled out, said, "Get in the car." And she did. And I can't remember, I don't remember whether she was all the way in or almost all the way in. I got the other one by the wrist, brought her around, and began to move her in under the steering wheel, push her across so I could just drive us right out of there. And if she had done that, we'd have been out of there and they would have been fine. At the last minute, she just put her hands on the door jamb and said, "Mister, I've been trained in nonviolence. I can take this. Don't worry about me. Don't you get hurt." And I was very frustrated about it. Might have cussed a little bit. And I tried to shove her in. And at that time, they were all over around us. And I was wheeled around, grabbed me by the arm, pulled me around. And I said, "The magic works, get back. I'm from the federal government. Or maybe I'm from the Justice Department." And I never saw the blow, but they hit me right there with a pipe. And I just never been knocked unconscious in my life. And I went out. I never felt the blow, never felt myself hitting the ground. I later sort of, you know, you think back on it, what did you feel and what did you do? Wasn't it strange that you didn't feel the blow? I thought I felt them kicking me under the car. And half an hour, Sullivan gave the mob to maul those Freedom Riders. And finally, after a half an hour, police lieutenant, whose name was Meadows, I think, took me out from under the car and took me around and put me in the passenger seat. And gradually I came around, and I remember I had borrowed. I'd been on the road now, you know, since I'd already gone to. I'd left Washington without going home. I'd gone straight to the airport. So I had no, and I'd been on the road 4 days, maybe 3 days, all the way down to getting from Birmingham to Montgomery. So I guess 3 days I'd been on the road. And I had borrowed a shirt that morning at the motel before leaving Birmingham from John Doerr. And now I'm in the car, unconscious, in the driver's, in the passenger seat, where I tried to put this young woman, Susan Wilbur. And gradually I started coming around. And then I woke up. And I sort of slumped, you know, and the first thing I saw was John Doerr. I borrowed a lovely sports shirt. It was drenched with blood. And my first thought is John Doerr was going to be pissed off at me. and then I sort of got my bearings, looked around, and this police lieutenant was just out. The window was open. And he said, "You ran into a little trouble, buddy. What happened?" And I said, "Well, I don't know." And he said, "Is there anybody I can call for you?" And I had the good presence of mind to say, "You can call Mr. Kennedy for me." And he said, "Well, Mr. Kennedy's," and I said, "the Attorney General or the White House." And he said, "Who are you, buddy?" And I said, "Well, I'm the fellow you've been reading about. I was down here to keep this from happening." And he said, "Well, I better get you out of the hospital, out of the car, get you to the hospital." So he gets me out of the car, I pass out again, and I wake up in Bartlett's clinic on an x-ray table being x-rayed. And Dr. Bartlett, who ran the clinic, was taking care of me. And as I wake up on the x-ray table, he's talking to Byron White, the Deputy Attorney General, later Supreme Court Justice. And Byron was a friend of mine, and Dr. Bartlett said, "Well, he's coming around now, and he has a hairline fracture, but he's going to be all right. We're going to keep him for a few days." And then I speak briefly to Byron, and he says, "Bobby has gone to your house over in Springfield to let your wife and son know you're all right, and he'll call you later." And so then they sedate me and put me in the hospital, and so I stay in the hospital, I guess, 3 days. At the end of the week, Martin King comes down to speak at a church. By that day, I was well. And the plane that brought him in from Atlanta was going then to Washington. And I was riding on that plane. Had a reservation. And so I go out in the ambulance, but I'm well by this, you know, I'm able to walk without staggering. So I sit in the front seat of the ambulance. And the driver takes me out on the concourse right next to where the plane is, so I don't have to, I've already got the ticket. I don't have to go through the terminal and have to go through that harassment that would have been there. So they take me out on the terminal, and Martin comes down the ladder from the airplane, and the U.S. Marshals are there to greet him and protect him. And I get out of the car. I had met him maybe 6 weeks earlier. He had come to the Justice Department and met with Bobby, and I had kept notes on their meeting, and so we knew each other. And it was really a mark of the man, I thought. Here he was surrounded by marshals who were worried about his safety. And I'm walking to go up the ladder on the airplane, and the marshals recognized me and said, there's John Siegenthaler who got hurt. And so Martin turns away from them, comes, walks, meets me before I get to the ladder, and gives me an embrace and said, so glad you're all right, and thank you for what you did. And it was a great moment, you know. So I get on the airplane, I go back to Washington, and that's sort of the story. So when you ask, what do I think about the Freedom Rides? I think the president and the attorney general and I, and most of the people in the administration, knowing how dangerous it was, and knowing there were cases like Emmett Till, you know, 40 martyrs of the movement, I think we had all hoped that the Freedom Rides would end without somebody getting killed. So that's what I thought. I would have wished that, you know, knowing that mob was there and that they could raise a mob in Alabama, Mississippi, and in 20 minutes, or most other southern states, I was just hoping that that we could get through it without any violence, and once there was violence and the Freedom Rides were dead, you know, my hope was that Diane would not send those riders down there, because I was certain in my own mind somebody would certainly get killed. And when I talked to her on the telephone that night, that, I mean that morning, and was saying that, she finally said, you don't understand. We know somebody's going to get killed. We all signed our last wills last night before they left here to come down there. And they had left in the morning, but they had met the night before and signed their wills and got the check cash and got the tickets. And so that's what I really hoped. I'd hoped that nobody would get killed, and because it was so dangerous, I feared that somebody, and John Lewis and Jim's work almost were killed that day. And, you know, I recovered pretty quickly, but they really hit me a tough lick. I mean, I never, can you imagine just going unconscious and never feeling it? And you think back on it when you wake up a half hour later and say, how could that have happened? I just lost a half hour of my life. So that's what I thought. It's a long answer to a very short, good question.
Great answer, thank you. Do you guys have any other questions? One I have is, you keep saying, you know, that you didn't want it to happen, and the Kennedy sure. administration didn't want it to happen. Hindsight's 2020, and we know that, you know, it turned out to be a success, but had the Freedom Rides not happened, do you think desegregation would have occurred like it did? Do you think it would have taken longer? Do you think there's a possibility that maybe it never happened?
No, it would have taken on if it hadn't been for Freedom Rides, and that if it hadn't been for that confrontation of federal and state power. I mean, when I went down, Bobby sent 200 U.S. Marshals into Montgomery, Alabama. And I remember late in the afternoon when he called, I was coming out from under the medication. And we talked, and he told me he had sent 200 Marshals in. And I sort of looked on that as a failure on my part. I had failed in the effort, as they had instructed, to provide safe conduct. And I felt bad about that. But if, you know, they took them And they, some of them, they stopped by jail. Most of them wound up in Parchment Prison in Mississippi, which was the hellhole of American prisons at the time. And I was afraid, and I think both President and Attorney General were afraid, that as dangerous as that prison was, they could get, somebody could get killed in prison, or that a guard. Now what happened was the Mississippi authorities understood that, and I think there were strict orders not to let them get hurt. If you look at the documentary on the Freedom Rides, there's only one inaccuracy in it, and that inaccuracy shows people in prison clothes, stripes, breaking rock at Parchment Prison. It doesn't say who they are, it just shows. That's really a file clip from years before. They didn't let those Freedom Riders out of their cells except for a half hour in the morning and a half hour in the afternoon, closely supervised fresh air and exercise. But they knew there that the whole world was watching, and they didn't risk Freedom Riders getting hurt by somebody. I think there were strict orders given, make sure these students stay in their cells, give them their exercise, don't let them get hurt. And otherwise, I mean, but even then, even under those conditions, I still was worried that somebody, some guard or maybe another, a white inmate, you know, would attack them. But it was a tough time. So the answer to the question is, I think had they not pricked the conscience of the country so that then hundreds of Freedom Riders came in from all parts of the country, filled up Parchment Prison. It was so crowded that the judges had to begin to let them out and were worried that they wouldn't come out. But of course they did. And but I think I do think that Freedom Rides were the seminal moment. I mean, the sit-ins had had a big impact, and the Montgomery Bus boycott had had a big impact. And some of the signs were coming down, and there were some compromises in various cities. But I don't think integration would have come as quickly as it had it not been for the Freedom Rides. And I don't mean just the first wave or the second, but that last wave where people came from all over the country willing to go to Parchment Prison. And you had ministers from New England and lawyers from the Middle West and people from all over the Deep South coming in there as Freedom Riders and suddenly winding up in jail. And so I do think it made a major difference. I also think the violence, quite often, violence inflicted on Freedom Riders changed a lot of public opinion and pricked the conscience of the country. Just because people wanted to ride a bus or sit at a lunch counter and be served, like as white people rode the bus or were served at lunch counters, I think the violence inflicted on them pricked the conscience of the country, and so it helped move attitudes from hardline to a more softer, to a softer stance, so that I think that conscience of the country prick began to change attitudes, and that was reflected, that change in attitudes was reflected in the politics of it too. Gradually politicians began to listen to people saying, you know, let's put this behind us, we don't need this, tearing up our towns, ruining our city's reputation. I know there was a long struggle in Birmingham, and finally, even though Mayor Haynes was strongly opposed to it, finally the city fathers just threw up their hands. The business community got behind it, and some of the other politicians got behind it, and that would bring about change. So I think if it hadn't been for the demonstrations, and specifically I think for the Freedom Rides, because those kids in Parchman Prison, I mean, you just held your breath every day, hoping you weren't going to hear somebody had been killed.
Do you guys have any other questions?
Answered most of my questions.
Yeah, actually, you did. your long answer pretty much took care of most of our questions.
I will run off at the mouth.